biographical work, the 佛祖同济, the general records of the Buddhist patriarchs of the 13th century, this text clearly contrasts the number of Indian monks bringing Buddhist texts to China, 80 monks, and Chinese monks returning from India with Buddhist texts, 183 monks, before the year 1035, in favor of the Chinese. This strong Sino-Indic or Sino-Indian network, as you could call it in that period, is clearly reflected by Chinese epigraphical sources from the exactly same period found in India. And these are the only Chinese inscriptions that have been found so far on the South Asian subcontinent. In the second half of the 19th century, a number of stone steles with Chinese inscriptions from between the mid-9th century and 1303 were discovered in Bodh Gaya and only in Bodh Gaya. Surprisingly, as I said, the only ones on the whole subcontinent. None of the earlier ones that have been recorded, we have heard about the one by Wang, commissioned by Wang, actually have survived. Now, what is peculiar in case of these Chinese inscriptions is the fact that some of them clearly again refer to imperial agency in connection with the respective monks' missions. The monks obviously performed what is known in the Buddhist context as Punya Parinama, the transfer of merit. So the emperor sent them to Bodh Gaya, and the merit that was gained actually fell back on the emperor. Inscribing the purpose of their coming to Bodh Gaya on behalf of the Chinese imperial court is therefore not very surprising. So this probably is the last quote I can make. Quote, Emperor of the Great Sung, the Empress Dowager had a stupa erected on behalf of Emperor Taizong under the rule of the saintly, civilized, circumspectly belligerent, benevolently illustrious, filially virtuous Emperor of the Great Sung, Renzong. The Empress Dowager, responsive to the origin, respected virtue, benevolent during her long lifetime, wholly through compassion, respectfully sent the monk Huaiwen to the kingdom of Magadha to construct a stupa next to the diamond seat. As an offering on behalf of Emperor Taizong, highly benevolent, responsive to the way of divine exploits, saintly virtuous, civilized and belligerent, circumspect and strong, highly intelligent, of great filial piety, the long string of Chinese imperial qualifiers. Emperor Taizong humbly wished to retreat to the heavenly palace, after death of course, to personally receive the prophecy of the Buddha that he would realize continuous residence in the position of a true immortal, that the veneration of Chakra and Brahman would bring about reward, and that his transcendent power would have the dynasty of the Sung prosper forever. This was recorded on the 19th day of the first month, the second year of the era Ming Dao, in the cyclical year Guiyo, inscribed on the Bingzi Day. So normally with Chinese texts, you get very concrete historical data information. Thank you very much.
Bravo. Our next speaker, the microphone,
are we going through one after the other?
Yeah, okay. If you'll trade places, that would be terrific. Neeraj Kumar, a representative of the government of India's deputy secretary. I was going to express deep admiration for a bureaucrat who also publishes widely and extensively with three books, rather great importance.
We argue to words, and may I use few of those to provide a glimpse of mankind's predicament at this juncture. Buddha dived into anusmriti, that is memorization, when he set to attain enlightenment. So he was just memorizing his own past, others' past, before deducting the concept of pratityasamutpada. Let us summarize the major fate transitions in our universe. Let us rememorize our own history, not as biological being as human, but the history of the whole universe. This is the model which I have developed based on the Buddhist paradigm. In Buddhist idioms, there are three lokas, Arup Lok, Kam Lok, and Arup Lok. I have actually shifted the lokas. Physical matter, that is the world of form, that is Rup Loka. And the dissolution principle in every loka is different. So for physical world, it is decay, that is D1. every matter decays, including protons, that they that may take as long as 10 to the power 29 years. From physical universe, what emerged? This is the biological world, kam loka, because everything, every living thing has some desires. And the corresponding dissolution principle is death, D2. At a particular juncture, human evolved with power of self-awareness, vimal shakti. And then now this IT revolution that is ongoing. And this has brought to the fore when we have a memory universe. And some people like Jaya Bodhya, they talk about simulacrum, which is pure world of images where anything can be copied and everything is as original as the original. So this is the Arup Loka, because there is no materiality, there is no substantiality. But the corresponding principle is D3, dementia, for human, man, for machines, one can say memory loss. So there this Kal Chakra tradition can provide a template how, because Kal Chakra Tantra, first they talk about, they are not like Madhyamakar. Madhyamakar only talk about sunyat through logic, but Kal Chakra Tantra, they believe in realizing that emptiness, that sunyat. So this is the difference. And they talk about severing the empty images. The ultimate realization in Kal Chakra is severing the images, sunyat, bim. So if we are only talking about bim, and this is the philosophy which I found from the 10th century, that it is obsessed with codes, mudra, chin, bim, and pratisena images, images in magical mirror, which does not have any objects. So I am just trying to fit it into this, whether this can be accepted by the future smart machines with the conscience. Thank you.
So I have been traveling to Buddhist sites that came up along the Asian High Road, the ancient Uttarapath, traversing through northern India. It started from Lahore and went towards Delhi, Sinapur, Varanasi, Allahabad, and then Patliputra and Rajgir. Today, roughly identified with the Sher Shah Suri Road and the modified Grand Trunk Road. It was one of the major trade routes of the subcontinent, sweeping across northwest India. Crossing the Gangetic Plains and going up to the port of Tamralipti in the Bay of Bengal, the Uttarapath and the Dakshinapath formed a colossal Buddhist corridor running through the length and breadth of India. A rough study of the expansion of Buddhism can be tracked on these highways, the long route covering several hundred kilometers of difficult terrain, including plains, river valleys, mountains, was the land of the Buddha. Scholars and pilgrims traveled to and fro in search of sacred texts and knowledge that disseminated from the renowned Mahaviharas on the Uttarapath. Ashokan inscriptions are found along these routes, and also stupas, rock-cut caves, monasteries, viharas, as cities on these routes were the hub of trade and commerce. Today, the eastern and northwestern extremities of this Asian high road lie in the countries of Bangladesh and Pakistan. We have these sites in Bangladesh. The monasteries and antiquities dug out during archaeological excavations and preserved in various museums in India and South Asia, still the most potent attraction for world tourism. World heritage sites are reportedly lying in 8 different Asian countries, including Pakistan, India, Nepal, Bangladesh. There are thousands of other equally important and beautiful sites that need to be preserved and connected with tourism. It is the responsibility of the government and tourism departments to monitor the status and connectivity of these sites, otherwise we may lose them to globalization, which is fast and taking over the rural landscape of India and Asia. Thanks.
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I appreciate all three panelists for adhering to the 20-minute time limit. You're great.